Okay, so welcome to the second part of our discussion of manifolds of mappings. The last time we introduced this concept of a canonical manifold, and we called a manifold of mappings canonical if the underlying topology is a compact open C-infinity topology, and we have an inbuilt version of the exponential law, namely, so we can test the smoothness of a mapping into the manifold of mappings by testing smoothness of the adjoint map, so the F wedge, which is defined on a Cartesian product of the two spaces N and K and into M, and this is often easier. So this exponential law is a crucial tool to establish results on these manifolds of mappings. For example, we can use it to get the following results, which we proved the last time. So given that we have a canonical manifold of mappings, then the evaluation map is smooth, which is a thing we certainly want. And we know that the canonical manifold structure of a manifold of mappings is unique, essentially, so up to diffeomorphism. Also, we have this lemma that if we have a submanifold, and for some reason we know that the smooth mappings into the submanifolds form a submanifold of the large manifolds of mappings, then we get that the submanifold structure is also a canonical manifold, and we have this identification, and that's the fourth item. If we have two canonical manifolds of mappings, and also their Cartesian product is a canonical manifolds of mappings, and it's basically isomorphic to the smooth mappings into the Cartesian product. Okay, so this is what we did last time, and now we want to reap a little bit more the benefits of having manifolds of mappings available. And we shall now see what we can do, for example, for the push forward and the pullback, and later for the composition mapping. So let's formulate first something, some proposition which is a little bit more general than what we had there. So let's assume we have two canonical manifolds of mappings and a smooth map from an open subset of the Cartesian product to to the manifold N. So there we have the Cartesian product K times M. And we single out an open subset in this Cartesian product. And so then we consider the associated set omega prime. It will be an exercise to see that this set omega prime is an open subset in the compact open C-infinity topology. So the omega prime is defined as all the functions in C-infinity Km such that the graph of this function is contained in omega. And the proof for this is a typical compactness argument. I working with the compactness of the graph of gamma to construct or to see that it actually forms an open subset of omega. Of the C infinity functions. Okay, so right. So this is the first result. As an exercise, we show that the omega prime is open. K is as always a compact manifold, and on this open subset we can define the mapping F star, which is defined as we send a mapping gamma to F composed with, in the first component we just insert the identity map, in the second component we insert gamma. So, and we want to see that this is a smooth mapping, right? Or that's what the proposition claims. After we know that the omega prime is open, we want to see that this is a smooth mapping. So let's see how we define this. However, in the following, since you might recall from the last time, so we also had the push forward, which we defined also with the lower star. In tech, the lower star we have here looks different than the lower star you see in the formula upstairs, but unfortunately it's hard to write this. So so I will use another name for this mapping F with the star we have here. So let's see how the proof goes. So let me just give you let's just define a new name for this mapping. So let's call this mapping F box for a moment. So this is a mapping from omega prime with values in the C infinity functions from k to n. And to remind you, it sends gamma to F composed with the identity on k and gamma. Okay, and as I said, we will now exploit the exponential law. So the first reflex one should have when studying the smoothness of such a map, we see that the F box is smooth if and only if the adjoint map F box wedge, and this is a mapping from omega prime times k with values in n, is smooth. And let's just work out what is the formula for this. So we have a gamma and a k, and where do we send it? We send it to F of k gamma of k. Okay, right. So we want to see that this is a smooth mapping. So on one hand, we already know that the F, or our prerequisite was that F is a smooth mapping on the following set. It's smooth on omega and goes into n. And the set omega was an open subset of k times n. And if a function gamma is in omega prime, if and only if, for all x, the pair x gamma of x, so this is an element, the graph of gamma is contained in omega. Okay, so what we now only have to see is that if we have the F box wedge of gamma and k, we can rewrite this. This is actually the map F, which we know is smooth on omega, evaluated in k, and then we have the evaluation of gamma in k, where the evaluation map is the one from the C infinity functions from k n times k, sorry, this should be an m, with values in m, and just takes gamma and k and sends it to gamma of k. And we've just seen in the last proposition that this is a smooth mapping because all of the manifolds we consider here are canonical manifolds. Okay, and so basically what the formula on the right-hand side, so this formula here shows now, is that the F-box wedge is a composition of smooth maps. Therefore, the F-box wedge is smooth. And this implies, conversely, that the F-box is smooth because we have the exponential law. This finishes proof. We can now, of course, sort of weaken our requirements a little bit and can, instead of doing this whole thing for an open subset of the Cartesian product, there's also a version where the open subset is the full Cartesian product, so we're not noting that. But let's note another corollary of this nice observation. So if we have two manifolds, which are canonical, and we have a smooth map, let's say G from M to N, this should be a smooth map, then the push forward G lower star from C infinity KM to C infinity KN, sending H to G composed with H, is smooth. And the proof is basically a piece of cake since we have the box map, the last one. So we define an auxiliary map. Okay, let's not call it H, let's call it let's call it F. Oh no, how did that happen? Ah, So we have this mapping F, and okay, so we have our mapping. Well, how do we define the mapping F? So this should be a mapping now defined on k times m, taking values in n, and we just send k and m to g of m. So k doesn't actually play a role here. Then f box is just the same as g star. And we're done. This establishes here the proof. Okay. Now, so we saw that basically for these manifolds of mappings, or these canonical manifolds of mappings, the push forward is smooth. We will see later that also the pullback is smooth, and in fact that actually the full composition map is also smooth. But before we do this, we specialize the situation a little bit more, because I actually want to go to a special construction employing the manifolds of mappings construction we saw in the appendix. And so let me just recall the usual trick, and actually the only trick in essence, which allows you to construct such a canonical manifold on an arbitrary canonical manifold structure for arbitrary target manifolds, is a local addition. And recall that a local addition is a smooth map defined on an open subset of the tangent bundle. The open subset should contain the zero section of the tangent bundle, which satisfies the following. So it sends the zero point over a given point back to the point itself, and then the mapping where we project onto the base point and use this local addition in the second component, this should induce a local diffeomorphism between the set U and the set U prime, which should be which is an open neighborhood of the diagonal in the Cartesian product of M with itself. So, and when you think back, or when you watch this video on why we want a local addition, this is what is facilitating the comparison between two functions which are not too far apart. So this diffeomorphism property allows us to construct from two functions which are not too far apart a vector field along the one function which points from the point where we are to the other point, to the corresponding point on the graph of the other function. Okay, so this is the role of a local addition. And we had several facts on local additions. So some useful facts. If M admits a local addition, so does TM. So the local addition is a mapping from TM to M. And now to get a local addition on for TM, we would need a mapping from the tangent bundle of the tangent bundle. It's usually denoted as T square M to TM. How do we get this? So it's very tempting to just take the tangent mapping of the local addition. And this is almost a local addition, but not quite. So what you basically see is if you evaluate this mapping in the zero section of the tangent of the double tangent bundle, then unfortunately we don't get the identity. And if you run through the identification and do the calculations, you see the reason for this is the following. So in local coordinates, we know that the tangent bundle, we have a local coordinate piece here, the chart t phi. So this goes, this local trivialization is the phi u times whatever the fiber is. So let's say the fiber is e. And so locally, we can basically think of the tangent bundle as being composed of pairs. So we have the base point and the vector component. Now, the double tangent bundle therefore has four components. So we have a base point, which is from the tangent bundle, and then we get two vector components, one for each component in the original one. And when you evaluate the T sigma now in an, so what is the zero section? The zero section is basically giving us two zeros here because that's the zero element in the vector component of the double tangent. Okay. And if you evaluate this, you see, I mean, what you actually want to get here, or what this should be xv. This is what we are looking for to get. Unfortunately, you don't get that because I mean, basically, we are not doing the calculations here, but the upshot will be that you can only get this if the v here exchanges its place with with the zero here. If you do that, then you actually get that the localization sends or that this mapping sends it to XV. So this is the mapping you get here. And to achieve this, we need to compose the tangent mapping with the so-called canonical flip, which I want to denote by kappa. So the canonical flip does the following. So if I have an element here in the double tangent bundle, so this can be defined in local charts and makes sense as a bundle map. So what the local flip does, or what the canonical flip does, it exchanges the second with the third component. This mapping is defined locally by this. And this is why we want, I mean, okay, and then you can prove that this guy here in the orange box is a local addition for TM. And then, so actually we really want this property because, so if we have a local addition on M, then we get a local addition on TM. And what we can do with it, we can use this to identify, I mean, so we basically know then, the following theorem follows from the construction in the appendix. So if M admits a local addition, and K is compact, then the infinity functions from K to M are a canonical manifold. Okay, and so the nice thing is, since local additions get inherited by the tangent bundles, so we also know already that the C infinity function with values in the tangent bundle also are a canonical manifold. And we can exploit this in the following way. So let us identify the tangent spaces of C infinity Km. How do we do this? Well, so let's let gamma be an element in C infinity Km. And let's assume we have something in this tangent space. So then we know in, from the description of the geometric description of the tangent space, we can find a curve on some open interval with values in the C infinity functions. So here we want that, we want that this curve is smooth. And so we want that at zero, it's this element, and the derivative at zero is V. So we are looking at one representative, of one smooth representative of this class. Okay, and now we see we have a smooth curve into a manifold of mapping, so we can use the exponential law. We can study the adjoint map. And this is also smooth. And the exponential law even yields more. So we know that under this identification, we can compute, so V is d dt, t equal to zero of C of t. And this is the same as we take the partial derivative of the adjoint map, then take the V of this, so we go back and set T to zero. That's actually a formula for the vector. So we can use the exponential or to go back and forth between those two things. Okay. And now let's take a look at what is dt, c wedge t dot. Okay. So when we freeze the t we have here, so but not the other component, then we get something from k. And since we have taken a derivative, a partial derivative in the first component, we are not ending up in m anymore, as we see up here. Where we end up is tm. And we see also that this mapping is smooth, as the original C wedge was smooth, and taking derivatives, also partial derivatives, doesn't change that. So we see that the guy we have sitting inside of this bracket here is a smooth function from k to tm, right? And there we can apply our V operation and actually turn this into a mapping into the smooth space of mappings, right? And so we see that T gamma C infinity from k to m, there's a mapping transforming this into a C infinity function from k to tm. This is basically taking the V, which is given by C dot zero, and we send it to d dt C wedge t. And then we take the V, and we want to do that at t equal to zero. Okay, and it's easy to see now, and this is a bijection under one circumstance. So, I mean, what do we get when we look at this formula here? Do we get all C infinity functions? Well, certainly not. If we are composing this bundle projection of M, T blank, what we get here is gamma. So let me write it down with an evaluation in K. This is gamma of k. Why? Because this curve C was passing at t, this at t equal to zero. At the point t equal to zero, this is passing over the points of gamma. The base point is gamma of k. And we have a vector component, but we forget the vector component by projecting down, and then we are just left with this gamma of k. So actually, we are not ending in arbitrary C infinity functions from k, which take their values on the tangent bundle. We end up at C infinity functions over gamma. So this notation is quite standard in certain circles. But what do I mean by this? So I define the space now as all the f in C infinity k tm, such that if I project with the bundle projection the f, then I get the gamma. And it's not hard to show that we actually get all such functions. So we can fiber-wise now identify the tangent bundle of the smooth functions with these with the manifolds of mappings, basically, or at least a certain subset of the manifolds of mappings. And one can show that there exists a bundle isomorphism which identifies the C infinity functions of the tangent space, or the tangent bundle of the C infinity function from K to M, with the C infinity functions from K with values in TM. And on each fiber, this bundle isomorphism is given by this assignment we have up here. Okay. And moreover, so since this is a bundle isomorphism over the identity, so here we have the usual bundle projection we always get for the tangent bundle. So this goes down to the C infinity from K to M. And what is in the identification, what is the bundle projection we have on the right hand side? It turns out, if you look at just this formula here, so this formula now, it turns out that it's just the push forward with the bundle projection of the target manifold. Push forward. Okay. Well, and so we have this identification, and let's take a look closer at what is happening. So we know already. I mean, what is it good for? The answer is not absolutely nothing. The answer is we can identify. So we have here the push forward with F, let's say. Yes. So, okay. And we know already that if F is smooth from M to N, then the push forward is also smooth. That was one of the previous corollaries. So we can ask ourselves, what is the tangent map? Here we have the tangent map of this push forward. And so it's clear because when we take the tangent map, then we have to take the tangent of the manifolds to the left and to the right. However, we have now an identification upstairs here, which gives us C infinity K Tm. And here we get C infinity K Tn. So the question is, we have these isomorphisms, and therefore we get an induced map here. Can we find a formula for this induced map downstairs? Okay, let's see how we do this. Usually, when we want to compute TF star, how do you do it? Well, we take the equivalence class of a curve moving through something. Right, and now by definition of this tangent map, this is the equivalence class of T goes to F F star applied to C of T. So at every time T, C of T is now a function, smooth function K to M. We can apply the F star. However, due to the calculations above, we see that instead of computing it like this, we can compute as follows. We can take partial derivative, this, of F star of C of T. We have to take the wedge of this. Then afterwards, we have to evaluate in T equal to zero and take the V. Okay, but now let's have a look at what this means. So we have F star of C of T, then the wedge. So by definition, this function is given, I mean, let's say we are evaluating this in, sorry, probably use a different notation here, but okay. So we are probably, so what we want to do, okay, we should put in a placeholder here. So, and then we want to evaluate that F afterwards in, so we get a function of two variables, a variable T and a variable K. And by definition, so C was something which goes from the interval minus epsilon epsilon, takes values in the C infinity function of Km. And the F was something from M to somewhere else. So when we run through the definition of what that means, so it's F of C of T of K. Or in other words, this is F of C wedge of TK. Right? So we can take the wedge inside of the star, so to speak. And now, so this means this is F composed with C wedge T, and then we have a blank here. Okay, and now if we derivate this, so this is a, so this equation here, or the derivative of this, is something which plays on the not on the manifolds of mappings, but in the for the adjoint map. We can just use the chain rule. This means we have TF of d dt c wedge t blank, and then we take the V here. Okay, and now we saw that if we take the wedge and we want to take it inside here along the F star, what we get is we can take the wedge inside, we threw it onto the C and was moving into the F star. And what was happening, sort of just on a, in a purely symbolic way, if you want, sort of the F star was losing its star. We just had an F here. And now we want to have the inverse operation. We want to take V of the whole affair. And again, we have a function composition here, TF. And then we want to V it and apply the V to what is inside here. And as you might guess, so the reverse operation is you have TF star. And then we are applying it to d dt c wedge t blank. So we get a V here, and then we get a t equal to zero. Okay. Right, and what this calculation shows us, I mean here, this is now something in C infinity over, let's say the base point is gamma k Tm. So it really makes sense to apply Tf to this. And so we have a push forward with Tf. Or in other words, this whole calculation shows the mapping, the tangent mapping of the push forward gets identified under the identification with the push forward with the tangent map. So this is a very important formula. So this identification of the tangent bundle of the manifolds of mappings with the C infinity functions into the tangent bundle allows us to identify the push the tangent map of the push forward with the push forward of the tangent map. And we will see this several times during the lecture that this is a very important formula. Okay, so in the presence of a local addition, we can not only identify the tangent bundles, but we also get very convenient formulae for the derivative of important maps, such as the push forward. There's an even simpler map formula for the pullback, which is also smooth. But to, towards the smoothness of the pullback, let's first prove the following proposition, which deals with, so let's K and L be compact. Compact manifolds. Assume that C infinity KM, C infinity LM are canonical manifolds. Since K and L are compact, we know that C infinity LK is automatically canonical. Then the composition map. Now this is the full composition. Comp taking C infinity KM times C infinity LK to C infinity LM, and F and G goes to the function composition F compose with G. This is smooth. Okay, and actually, so thanks to an observation of Gartelle, the proof basically due to the exponential law is just the same as in the categorical one. So comp is smooth. if and only if the adjoint map comp which C infinity Km times C infinity LK to missing one of the arguments times L with values in M. And this takes F and G and L and sends it to F of G of L is smooth. Okay, but observe that this formula here can be rewritten as the evaluation of F in the evaluation of G, and we evaluate G as L, right? We know already that the evaluation maps are, these Fs are smooth due to the manifolds being canonical. Okay, and therefore this associated map is smooth, and also the composition map is smooth. So this is a consequence of the exponential law, which is quite nice. This is sort of the canonical, the categorical version of this. Okay, and finally, so I mean we have now the composition map, and we could have also derived the smoothness of the push forward, since it's a partial map of the composition. Also, the smoothness of the pullback follows from this. Let me show you one more thing which happens often in the presence of local additions, and this is the so-called lifting of geometric structures to manifolds of mappings. How does this work? Or what we shall see is that it often happens that geometric structures can be lifted to manifolds of mappings, and an example of this is the so-called Stacey-Roberts lemma, which says, so let's assume we have a submersion between finite dimension manifolds. Right, and so we know already the push forward is smooth. The question is, does the push forward inherit the geometric properties of P? So in this case, is the push forward of a submersion, again, a submersion of the infinite dimension manifolds of mappings? And the answer here is yes, it is. So that's the content of the Stacey-Roberts lemma. The push forward of a submersion between finite dimensional manifolds, and that's important here, is again a submersion. Unfortunately, the proof is rather involved, so we will not discuss it in the lecture, because this requires basically that you hand tailor your local additions so that the produced local additions yield submersion charts for the push forward. And this is rather painful to do. So, we are just stating the Stacey-Roberts lemma, which is quite useful, since we know that submersions can be used to construct submanifolds. So we can use this result to construct submanifolds of the manifold of mappings. And this is an example of how geometric properties of a mapping or a space or whatever can be lifted to the infinite dimensional manifolds of mappings. And in the following chapters, we will see several examples of how geometric structures can be lifted to manifolds of mappings. So this will follow us through the rest of the lecture.